This video is brought to you by Captivating History. Too often, we trace the past, trying to pinpoint the exact beginning of something we later call a revolution. Revolutions don't begin with a single act, but rather the convergence of, or divergence of, ideas, practices, and beliefs to a focal point. That focal point is often considered the match that started the fire, though the fire couldn't exist without its fuel already in place. The Industrial Revolution resulted in the rise of urban populations, the creation of mass quantities of consumer goods, and the eventual transformation of society. As a whole, its rise is a bit easier to track than other movements. Images of dark, smoke-belching towers, powerful locomotives, and a new class of wealthy, called robber barons in the US, are commonly considered the results of this revolution. But what ignited this fire? What sparked its beginning? Just coming to an end, the Renaissance had changed the path of history. The Protestant Reformation split England from ties to the Pope and the European continent, and the rise of the merchant class soon followed. But that movement didn't ignite the Industrial Age. A damp, foggy, mid-18th century England may not seem like a likely origin for this spark, but it was. The process started with sheep. The English raised sheep, turning fleece into wool, which was then spun into fabric, becoming shirts, pants, and blankets. Since the Norman conquest 7 centuries before, the English countryside was dotted with small cottage weavers. Weavers were often a single family working with their own flock's wool, but sometimes a group of 6 or so combined their efforts to attract more trade. Thread from wool was painstakingly made by hand. The physical effort of separating the fibers that were then spun into a single thread kept the textile industry small and isolated. When the English Empire moved across the Atlantic to the Southern American colonies, a new fabric, cotton, began to replace wool as a new source of cloth. In the New America, cotton was being grown and woven into fabric, but they faced the same challenges as their counterparts in England. That was about to change. Revolutions ride one of two waves, either a flood of available raw materials or a shortage of those same materials leads to innovation. Ways are discovered to profit from the excess, or methods are invented to fill a supply gap when a product is scarce. In 1733, the English inventor John Kay created the flying shuttle, a device that quickly moved thread back and forth across the loom, pounding the thread into place, then repeated the process. Weaving speed increased dramatically as yards of cloth rolled out from the loom. The flying shuttle was so effective that small textile mills quickly ran out of thread. Individual families couldn't produce enough wool from their own flocks, and importing American cotton was too expensive. Adding to difficulties was a lapse in the supply chain, as the cotton lint was difficult to separate from the large seed inside each cotton boll. Demand far exceeded production. An English carpenter and part-time weaver, James Hargreaves, dreamed up a solution. The spinning jenny came to life in his imagination, eventually taking form as an improved spinning wheel that could produce 8 threads at a time. The machine quickly evolved to produce 120 threads at a time. The demand was met. Cloth began to pour out of small shops, even where there were just 1 or 2 manual weavers left. But these people were the peasants of the late medieval period, tied to the land as serfs by the English feudal system. In Europe, land meant power, influence, and above all else, wealth. The new American gentry defied those traditions, and a new class of people rose with the flowering cotton in the southern colonies. Land was inexpensive in the vastness of the American continent, and soon a new wealthy aristocratic class sprang up on the backs of African slaves. Still, more spark was needed. Textile mills grew larger, but the looms were still powered by the arms and legs of the men and women operating the equipment. Muscle, wind, or water were the only power sources humans could use, until the late 18th century. Water wheels as a source of power date back to the Roman Empire. In the 1760s, English inventors began using the central shaft of the water wheel as a power source to flip the flying shuttle-style looms automatically. Still, to produce something as modest as a modern 3-horsepower engine took a water wheel 20 feet in diameter, fed by a water source delivering 3,000 gallons of water per minute. There were a few locations in England capable of this combination. Many more were found in New England with its myriad streams, but colonial competition with the established textile trade in England was discouraged. Discouraged or not, profit drives innovation, trade, and business despite government interference. With two more inventions, the powered American textile mill came into full production, heralding the Industrial Revolution's arrival in earnest. Another English inventor, Richard Arkwright, perfected the complex system of pulleys, idler pulleys, belts, and shafts needed to convert water to usable power. The water wheel era of textile milling was short-lived. In 1790, Arkwright connected James Watt's newly invented steam engine with a central power shaft similar in design to the water-powered textile mill. The combination of steam and the shaft and pulley system created the spark for the Industrial Revolution. However, the exponential increase in weaving speed quickly dried up cotton supplies. Just 2 years after the first steam-powered mill went into operation, another American inventor found a way to supply the incredible demand for cotton. Eli Whitney patented the cotton gin in 1792, a device that increased the production speed of cotton lint by over 100 times. The first cotton gins were hand-cranked, but the steam engine was quickly adapted to power larger cotton gins. Cotton bales began to line the docks of Charleston, New Orleans, and Savannah. Plantations rose along the major rivers. The English called for an end to the African slave trade, and the newly founded United States followed suit in 1808, officially ending the practice, though bootleg slave ships continued to operate for decades. There was no altruism in the terminating of the Middle Passage. The motive was entirely economic. Slaves would now be raised in America and sold on auction blocks across the South, increasing the revenue stream for wealthy Southern plantation owners. The Industrial Revolution had arrived, partly through innovation and partly on the backs of an entire race of enslaved people. The revolutionary change in manufacturing wasn't welcomed by everyone. Change never is. Working conditions in the 18th and early 19th century English textile mills were atrocious. Injuries were common in working conditions that were cold, wet, and dangerous. Still, it was a stable wage in an era of economic upheaval. Steam-powered mills began to eliminate many manual labor jobs. The response was the Luddite movement. Luddites were bands of English workers violently opposed to any technology that took away or changed their manual labor lifestyle. Their answer to the revolution was to break machines, sabotage steam engines, with occasional open revolts that had them burning machinery, destroying it, or tossing it into nearby rivers. They deeply feared being replaced by machines, viewing progress as the end of their family traditions, along with a quick trip to the desolation of poverty. Textile manufacturing led to a demand for iron rather than wooden mill components. Steam engines created power for dozens, then hundreds, of power looms. These looms required larger buildings that evolved into the world's first factories. The demand for iron was fueled by replacing charcoal with coke, a form of purified coal. Welsh coal mines fueled English industry, but couldn't compare with the vast streams of coal discovered in Pennsylvania and the western counties of Virginia. By the 1840s, the Industrial Revolution was in full swing in the United States. It spread across the face of Northern Europe as well. Mining increased, iron production increased, and railroads and steamships soon replaced wind, water, and muscle power. New generations of agrarian people with a farming heritage dating back generations began to leave home to be nearer the factories. Cities sprang up around the factories, creating all the inherent urban sprawl we've become accustomed to. The Industrial Revolution not only changed the ways of working, but it also changed ways of living, making it one of the most important revolutions in the world's history. To learn more about the Industrial Revolution, check out our book, The Industrial Revolution, A Captivating Guide to a Period of Major Industrialization and the Introduction of the Spinning Jenny, the Cotton Gin, Electricity, and Other Inventions. It's available as an ebook, paperback, and audiobook. Also, grab your free Mythology Bundle ebook for free while still available. All links are in the description. If you enjoyed the video, please hit the like button and subscribe for more videos like this.